Okay, thank you. It's a joint work with Sebastian Faust, Vladimir Komogorov, and Krzysztof Pietrzak. So the general idea is we introduce a new concept, which we call proof of space. And it's a type of a proof of effort, where effort will be measured in terms of wasted memory. It's sort of an alternative to the proofs of work. I was talking about proofs of work yesterday, but let me just briefly go through these definitions again. So for the purpose of this talk, we will look at proofs of work as a tool for dealing with the Sibylle attacks. So Sibylle attacks are, well, it's popular attacks. This is a popular term in the systems community. But what they mean by this term is simply situation when you have like some resource and you have like lots of people who want to use it. And if you don't have anything like a public key infrastructure or a way to distinguish people, then dishonest guys, one dishonest guy can create lots of fake identities and do something bad. Okay, so this is what they call a Sibylle attack, and the proof of work can be viewed as a tool to combat these attacks. They were introduced by Dwork and Naor in actually at this conference in 1992. Their initial motivation was a countermeasure against spam, but well, as I said, they can be used for other purposes. So the basic idea is to force the users to do some computational work, which is it's like moderately hard. Okay, so it's a moderately hard puzzle, and the checking correctness of this puzzle should be quick. Okay? So how they are used? They can be used in many different ways, but let's think about the following. So let's say there is some identifier ID, so say it's an email address of some user, and we want to make sure that someone doesn't create like 1 million different email addresses or something. And suppose that they are different for each execution. So there will be a verifier in this proof, and suppose that, for example, this ID somehow contains some nouns generated by the verifier. So you have a verifier and a prover, and you have they both know this ID, and now the prover computes some solution of the proof of work on the ID and sends it to the verifier, and the verifier checks correctness, outputs accept or reject, and this should be slow, so it takes like 1 minute, and this should be very fast. Okay. So these are proof of work, and they have many different applications. So you can say, that, for example, you have some cloud computing or something you want to prevent people from abusing it. You can prevent people from launching denial of service attacks. And the recent application is Bitcoin cryptocurrencies in general. OK, so how to measure computational difficulty? Well, the original method was the number of computing steps. Some later works actually also defined the computing difficulty in terms of the times of the memory is accessed. I'm mentioning these papers here because it may sound like it's similar to what we do because it also somehow measures memory, but it's something else because they were just measuring the numbers of steps, the number of times the memory was accessed. Okay, so it's something else, although the techniques are sometimes similar. Okay, so what is the drawback of this proof of work? So, well, one is high energy consumption. Okay, so it's visible in Bitcoin, and some people even call Bitcoin environmental disaster because using proof of work consumes energy. It costs money. And well, for example, in Bitcoin, the problem is that it gives advantage to people with dedicated hardware. Okay? Sometimes people think it's a problem, sometimes not. But anyway, it's some feature that sometimes may be undesirable. So it's much faster to solve proof of work if you do it on hardware, if you do it on ASICs. Okay? That's why everybody's mining on hardware now. OK, so what to do? So this problem seems to be sort of unavoidable because to prove that you invested a lot of computing power, you need to do this computation, right? It's almost tautological, right? So that's the only way you prove that you do work, you actually do this work. And the question is, is there any other resource you could use? And that's where our new concept comes. We suggest to use space, okay? So we call it proof of space. And instead of CPU, we'll use disk space. So an example of an application, just to fix something. So suppose we have a cloud service like email system, whatever, Gmail, something like this, and the goal is to prevent malicious users from opening lots of fake accounts. So let's say we will force each account owner to waste a large part of his local space. Okay? So whenever you open a Gmail account, you have to like allocate 100 gigabytes on your hard disk of some, you have to fill it in with some data. And what's very important, okay, this is one of the most important features, of this primitive is this space needs to be allocated for the whole duration of the period where the user is using the system. Okay, so as long as I want to use the system, I will have to waste this 100 megabytes. Okay, so it's not enough that I, or 100 gigabytes, it's not enough that I do it once. Okay? It will have to stay there. So what's the main difference from this and the proof of work? So you can look like this this way. So as I said, to prove that you dedicated n CPU cycles, you have to really perform these cycles, while to prove that you wasted n bytes, does not for this proof, you will not need to touch all these bytes. Okay, so it will be more efficient, and I will show you in a moment what I mean by this. But, well, our main motivation is that it should be more efficient than the proofs of work. So what are the advantages? Well, as I said, more energy efficient. There is no hardware acceleration because we'll be just storing bytes, so storing bits. So there's nothing like dedicated hardware for storing particular bits, right? And it should be cheaper because, well, for the second reason here, this is implied by this. So it's cheaper because, well, people can really use their unused disk space for this. Okay, so the problem with proof of work for Bitcoin was the initial motivation for Bitcoin was that people can use unused CPU cycles. But first of all, it costs energy, and second, it's now not profitable because everybody mines in hardware. Okay, so hopefully with proof of space, this would be different. Okay, so let's think a little bit about what would be security definition of something like this. And well, the first natural question is how to measure time and space. So here, we will measure time in terms of the number of calls to the random oracle. Okay, so that's basically the only thing you can do here. If you want to have some formal proofs, you have to use a random oracle model. And well, the space will be measured in blocks of length L, which think of it as the output of a hash function. Okay, so say 256 bits or something like this. Okay, so and again, the proof will be done with respect to some identifier ID, and you have prover and the verifier. They both know this ID. So say this is an email address of this guy, and the ID is an email address of this guy, and this is a Gmail. So well, first there will be some initial phase during which we will fill in the memory of the user with some random data. They will not really be random, but think of it as random, like n blocks. So n is a parameter of length L. And then, after this is done, and this can take a while, this first step, then every now and then, the verifier will check if this data is still there. Okay? So there will be this proof phase, and this proof phase, the prover will look on some blocks on R. Okay, he will not look at the entire R, but he will look at some. So essentially, the verifier will ask him to provide some blocks from here, okay? And so on. And this can be done periodically. For example, once a day, Gmail will check if the user still stores this data. Okay, and at the end, the verifier says accept or reject. So how to define security? So first of all, we would like some kind of completeness. That's a simple requirement that if everybody is honest, then the verifier accepts. Then soundness and efficiency. And this is a little bit less trivial to define, so I will have it on the next slides. So how to, first let's start with efficiency. To tell you what is the tricky part in this definition, I will show you an example of an efficient, of a not efficient proof of space, like a trivial one. And of course, I haven't defined security yet, so I will stay on the intuitive level, but it should be clear that it is secure, it's just inefficient. So a trivial proof of space works like this. So in the initial phase, the server sends random data to the user. The user simply stores it, and then the server will be asking for some subset of indices. Okay, so it should be capital N here, sorry, of size K. And the user will be replying with this. Okay, so basically the verifier just asks for a couple of random blocks and the user has to reply. Okay? and the verifier checks if the answer is correct. And of course, the verifier can actually store, generate R pseudorandomly, so he doesn't need to store R himself. He can just store the seed. Okay? So this works, but it should be kind of obvious that to pass this verification, the prover needs to store a significant fraction of R, okay? Because otherwise he would not be able to answer the questions. And the only problem with the solution is that this initialization phase requires to do a lot of work. In particular, it requires the server to send the whole string to the prover, right? Of course, he cannot send the seed, right? Because then they would not be secure, right? Okay, so we require, our efficiency requirements are like this, that basically everything should be very efficient except of maybe the initialization phase for the prover. Okay? So this, of course, this imposes limits also on the communication complexity. So by efficient, we mean polynomial in the logarithm of n and the security parameter. And only here where obviously the prover needs to work at least linear time in n because he needs to fill in his memory, right? So this is normal that he will have, and actually this constants are small in our results, so it will be like this poly here will be, actually in most of cases will be just k times log n. Okay, so how to define soundness? So now we are back to the definition of security. And the reason why I have it in this order is that actually, you will see this in a moment. So informally, we would like to cheat the prover to constantly waste a lot of memory, right? So what would be his goal if he's cheating? His goal would be to compress R, okay? So instead of storing R, he would store some shorter X, okay? Of some like N0 blocks, okay? Which is much less than N. And then each time he needs to prove he needs to execute this proving phase, he would he would just look at X and probably just expand X to recover R or do something else, right? He doesn't need to do it, but anyway, he would try to respond to the questions in this proof phase by looking at the compressed R, which is X, and so on. Okay, so somehow, here this the problem that it's easy to see that a cheating prover, if you formulate the problem like this, the cheating prover has a simple but not necessarily efficient winning strategy. Okay, so what he can do is he can first in this initial phase he can just simulate the user, right, the honest prover, and then erase R and store only messages that he received from the server, right? And it's actually a variant of this, what I said a moment ago, that, well, obviously it's not correct if this if only seed is sent, right? So think of it like if this is just one-way communication, then the adversary here, he could simply store what was sent. Well, in general, it can be more rounds, so let's say he just stores the entire transcript of communication, right? And then he stores, and then here, we said that we want this X, we want this communication to be short, right? So the messages that come from the server are short, which means that he can store them in a small space, right? And then, of course, you can see what's happening. So before each proof starts, the adversary would just expand X back to R by simulating the proof. Okay. So he would simulate for the honest prover his conversation with the server. Okay. And then once the proof phase is over, he erases it and he again compresses his memory to X. Okay. So this is a problem. And well, a moral is that we need somehow to restrict the power of a cheating prover. Okay. So the computing power here. Okay. That's why also this phase here, the initial phase, will require to the prover, honest prover, to do some work. Okay. Okay, so we can restrict his operating time or space. We say that a dishonest prover P dash is N0 N1 T cheating prover if the following holds. So this N0 is the size of his storage after the initial phase. Okay, so this is what he remembers after this init. This would be this length of x. N1 is space used by the dishonest prover during the proof, and t is time used during the proof. Okay, so basically there are two ways, right, to restrict two basic ways to restrict efficiency of an algorithm. One is to limit the space, and another one is to limit time. So we have both. We can restrict space or time, and we don't actually need to restrict his power during the initial phase, so he can, as long as he is not like exponential, so that he can simply break the random oracle. Okay, so in fact, in our paper, we just restrict either space or time, so we will have either like N0, N1, infinity cheating prover, which means we just restrict his space in this proof phase, or the other way around, we just restrict his time. Okay, so what is the security definition? Well, it's now quite straightforward. We say that a protocol is N0, N1, T proof of space if it's complete, efficient, and sound, where like completeness and efficiency was already defined, and soundness means what you would expect, right? So that for every N0, N1, T cheating prover, the probability that he convinces the verifier is negligible. Okay, so now I have a few minutes to talk about our constructions. So why are the constructions non-trivial? Well, because of time memory trade-offs. Well-known thing in cryptography, so sometimes you can, what happens when you start to like analyze trivial solutions, like simple solutions for this problem, you will end up with solutions that can be broken with time memory trade-offs. So for example, like the adversary, instead of storing n blocks, will store like, n should not be in this. Instead of storing n blocks, he would store square root of n blocks, and he would run in time square root of n. Right? These are like time-space trade-offs, where like baby step, giant step type of thing. Okay, so for many easy ideas for solving this problem actually break here. Okay, so what is our main technique? We will use something called graph pebbling. Okay, so there's not much time to explain the details, but I'll just go quickly through it. So suppose we have a graph, we have a hash function that depends on the identifier. So for execution on the protocol is different. Say it hashes also this ID at the beginning, concatenates with the rest of its input. And we construct this R1 to Rn as follows. So let's say this is a simple graph. And well, what we do is first we label vertex 1 and 2, so this is simply hash of 1, hash of 2, and then the vertex 3 will be labeled with the hash of R1, R2, and so on. Okay, okay, should be 3 here. Okay, so and this is a function that takes an ID and produces a long string R1 to Rn. And informally, a graph is bad if it can be quickly labeled if one stores a small number of labels, okay? Because of labels. So, example of a bad graph is something like this, where like if this is this baby step giant step, basically. So, if the adversary stores every square root of labels, like the one number square root of n, the number of the two square root of n, then he can compute every label in square root of n steps, right? This is like a standard thing. So we need graphs where this kind of attacks are impossible. And we construct them basically we need graphs where this kind of time-space trade-offs are hard. And we use techniques from graph pebblings. And we use some classical results. Actually, you can see on the list of the authors that one of the authors is not cryptographer and not is Vladimir Komogorov, and he was mostly responsible for this graph part. Okay, so the details are in the paper. Okay, so how to build a proof of space from a good graph? So it's quite simple, right? So now I'm going to show you like a scheme that is sort of stupid, and then I'll show you how to repair it. So you compute R, like you expand this ID using this scheme that I showed you. And well, in this stupid scheme, first the prover will send R to the server. Okay?
So you can see why it's stupid, because it still requires long communication. And then, well, again, the simple protocol that we had before. So of course, as I said, the problem is that the entire R needs to be sent to the verifier. So our solution is, well, also quite straightforward. So we let the prover to commit to R using Merkle tree. Okay, so those are Merkle trees, we all know them. And the what the prover will send will be this commitment, the top of the tree. And then the verifier will ask randomly to open some commitments. He will check if everything was computed correctly. And of course, the problem is that he can still cheat small number in a small number of blocks. But we take care of it in this proof. It's just an additional difficulty in the proof. So now in the proof phase, the prover just opens the Merkle commitments. So as a result, in the initial phase, he doesn't need to send the entire tree. It's enough that he sends the commitment. And then he proves in the proof phase form that it was done correctly. OK, and these are the results. So we have two proof of space schemes. So this C1 and C2 are some constants. And we have a proof of, so this is, you remember the parameters. So this is the memory bound after the initial phase. This is the memory bound on the during the execution of the proof. So in this first one, it's like n divided by log n, n divided by log n, and we don't restrict the time, so he can have as much time as he wants during the proof phase. And in the second result, we have like linear, and we bound time, not space. Well, there is some small additional assumption that we needed to do. The details are in the paper. A natural question, and this is what I'm going to, I still have 1 minute left. So the natural question is, can you build a cryptographic currency on top of it, right? And it's not so trivial because you need this, if you look at Bitcoin, then there is this notion of a random new block on which everybody mines, and somehow it's clear that this doesn't work here. But fortunately, there is a recent paper by Park et al., which is on IPRIT now, where they construct something like this. Well, I should also say, this is my last slide, I should also say about some previous related independent work. So so the graph pebbling, I mentioned the important work. So graph pebbling was used in the context of the proof of work already before by Dworkinauer and Wee. Now there is something like proof of secure erasure, which is something like similar to what we have, but it lacks two phases. It's just like a one phase thing. So you just have to prove that you, at some point, you spend a lot of memory, and then you can compress. And this was introduced by Perita and Sudik in 2010. And then you have other constructions like Carvelas and Chiayas and Atinese et al., where they actually call it proof of space also, so there was some confusion about the names. But basically, this proof of space that we have, they imply this proof of erasure. Okay, so our notion is stronger. And well, I should also mention that similar graph techniques were used by a paper by Smith and Tsang in the context of leakage resilient crypto. And this paper was not published on ePrint. Okay, thank you.